Hello, everyone. I'd like to welcome you back to this amazing series that we've been going through, myself and Dr. Jay Smith, that has to do with the historical criticism of Islam. We talked at the beginning about the fact that Islam presents specific dates related to the birth of Islam and the birth of the Prophet, yet discoveries are contradicting that. Then we talked about Mecca, the historical, place for Mecca according to the Islamic tradition versus the discoveries that are contradicting that as well. Then we began to take a look at what we call the Qibla, which is the direction for prayer. And we discovered also that new discoveries, especially archaeological discoveries, have also contradicted some of the Islamic views related to the change of Qibla, our direction of prayer from Jerusalem, at least according to the Islamic own understanding, to what we call today Mecca, even though the Quran really never mentioned both of these names when in 624 that direction changed. Dr. Jay, thank you again. And I think today we have a very interesting analysis that will conclude all of what we have talked about. So I'll give it over to you now.
Yeah, let's just review and let's go back up on the slide again. Remember the four Qiblas to get us into it. The first Qibla, up until 706, every mosque was facing Petra. None of them were facing any other direction but Petra, from as far away as Guangzhou, way over there in China. You can see that on the map. You can see Chattamon and Juma. That's way down in South India. All of them, thousands of miles away, were uniquely facing Petra. Then you have a second Qibla that's introduced in 706, in the early 8th century, to place in between, almost exactly halfway between Petra and Mecca, showing you that there's something, there's an agenda here.
That's right.
So we're going to get to that agenda, but let's hold on before we explain it, because we don't want to jump the ship. Then finally, it's not till 727 that you finally get a mosque that's facing Mecca, where it should have been facing from 624. Because that's, according to the Quran, is when the Qibla was canonized. 624, we have to wait 100 years, over 100 years, 103 years, before we finally get a mosque that is facing Mecca. And then by 876 is when all mosques start facing. So there's still mosques that are facing other directions. And then you get a fourth Qibla, as you see on the slide there, and that's the parallel ones, the ones from North Africa. Why are they parallel? Why are they not facing Petra or Mecca? They seem to be facing a line that that follows between Petra and Mecca. That's why we call it the parallel mosque. So four different Qiblas. When we look at a graph there, you can see that the most accurate of those Qiblas is the between ones. That's a political statement there. You can see why. And then the second most accurate would be the Petran, which are the earliest one. You would then expect them to be the least accurate.
That's correct.
Because how do they have the technology? Ah, that's interesting. And the least accurate of all the four Qiblas is the Meccan Qibla.
Which is the later one.
Which is the third one. But obviously, they didn't have that much accuracy. Muslims are trying to say they're the most. No, they're not. Look at the statistics. The most accurate are the between ones and the Petran ones. They're much more accurate than the Meccan ones. Now, what's the significance of Petra? That's what we need to get to. Why Petra? What is this? Well, what is Petra? Well, take a look at this trade route map. Look where all the trade routes go through.
They go through Petra.
Obviously. Almost all of them go through Petra. It is the seat of trade from the Far East, way off from China and India. All the spice trade, all the Silk Route, they all come through Petra. So what is Petra? Well, Petra is a Nabataean. It's the sanctuary city for the Nabataeans. The Nabataeans existed from the 2nd century BC up until 713. Look at that date, 713 AD. They had their sanctuary in Petra. Now, when you look at Petra today, you can see there's some pictures of it. You can see it's the city of tombs and temples. It is not a political capital. It is a religious capital. It's where the sanctuary is for the Nabataeans.
Right.
Hugely significant. Muslims should know that because Mecca is their religious capital, but it's not their political capital. It never has been their political capital. Even when Muhammad was living, according to their tradition, Medina was their political capital.
That's correct.
And we do know the Umayyads, who were the next great dynasty, they made Damascus their headquarters, never Mecca.
That's correct.
And the Abbasids made Baghdad their headquarters. So it's significant here that we need to understand that the Nabataeans did not use Petra as their political capital. It was their religious capital. It was their sanctuary. The Byzantines the same way. The Christians, Jerusalem was not their capital. Constantinople was their political capital. But Jerusalem is where the Church of this of the Sepulchre is. That was the religious headquarters for the church in Jerusalem, and same for the Jews as well. So now let's go and let's look at this city of tombs and temples. Take a look at what we've noticed about Petra. Petra, according to that slide there, it's in a valley. Remember, all the traditions say that this place where the prophet lived is in a valley. That fits Petra. That it has a stream going through it. That really fits Petra. We have now found water courses. We found cisterns there. There are all kinds of evidence of water streams. There is a parallel valley there. We see that. You can see them right there on the map looking of Petra. Yeah,
two valleys going.
There are the two valleys. It would be near Lot's Pillar of Salt because that is actually where Lot would have come from, right outside of what is today Petra or in Jordan. It has fields. Al-Bahri says that. It has trees, grass, fruit, and loam. That comes from Tirmidhi and Bukhari and Al-Tabari. It has olive trees because it's right there around the Mediterranean. Correct. Where the olive trees would have been grown. And it has mountains all around it. That's why
overlooking.
Oh, right, overlooking. So if there had been a Kaaba there, it would be there. Petra has all the items listed above from the Qur'an in Islamic traditions. Thus, could it be Petra that that both the traditions and the Qur'an are referring to? Because remember, it doesn't give a name to it. It just says the place of the prophet.
And by the way, I mean, I'm just throwing this out there. There has been a recent discovery in Petra, at least the foundation of what appears to have been a shrine.
That just was found last year.
That's right.
They're still discovered. And they found it by looking at from satellite imagery from space.
Correct.
It's so big that they're now starting to dig it. We're waiting with licking our lips because I can't wait till I find and dig underneath it and inside it to see if maybe that's the sanctuary.
That's
that all that we're looking for. That possibly could be it. Hold that there. Even
especially
in a year from now,
we'll
be able to say more.
Talking about maybe.
Hopefully. Now let's go back to the references in the Quran to Ad Thamud Midian. Take a look. Ad Thamud Midian. What are they round? What are they next to? Look on the map.
They're around Petra.
They're all around the Nabataean area and Petra. If there's any prophet who has daily contact with these people, it would be in Petra, not in Mecca. Look at Mecca.
It makes perfect sense because he is surrounded by these people and towns, I should say.
Now can you understand why there are so many references to Thamud Ad in Midian
exactly.
In the Quran? All the geographical cases makes it. So what's the significance? Let's now review what we have noticed so far. And here we're going to do a look at the slide again. What is the first thing? Nothing is known about Muhammad until the late 7th century from Arab sources. His book, the Quran, is in its manuscripts, don't appear until the early 8th century. We saw that from the previous episodes that
correct.
We talked about.
Correct. We talked about that earlier.
His city, Mecca, isn't referred to until the mid-8th century, 741 to be more specific.
We talked about that in early parts.
His biography, the Sira, and his sayings, the Hadith, don't appear until the early and late 9th century. We talked about that earlier.
That's right.
Thus, much of what we know of Muhammad is written down hundreds of years later and hundreds of miles away. It looks like he is nothing more than a later redaction. Redaction means to put back into
exactly. A historical
setting.
Someone reading it 200 years later as if it happened 200 years earlier.
I would say not 200 years. I would say Abdul Malik.
And I would say I'm just throwing this number out there. It's almost like you're doing it backward instead of forward.
It looks like you need to go to Abdul Malik. Abdul Malik. Abdul Malik is the one we need to do that. So let's put out a possible scenario. Now this is, okay, Al-Fadi, this is us saying in 2018. This is what we think happened. From everything we've gleaned, from everything we looked at in these episodes, what is the scenario we're looking at? Let's look at the screen there. To make sense of all this, we need to begin with Abdul ibn Zubayr.
Abdullah ibn Zubayr, that's right.
The governor of Petra under Abdul Malik, the Umayyad caliph from 685 to 705. Zubayr rebels in 683 against the Umayyads. Take a look at where their political capital is. Politically speaking, if they were Muslims, they should have been in Medina. But they're not.
At least, exactly.
They're way up in Damascus. That's even further north.
That's right.
That is not 600 miles away. That's almost 1,000 miles away, way up in the north. What are they doing way up there if their base is in Medina, in Mecca?
Correct.
So you can see already that all the historical reference points have it in the wrong place, according to the Islamic narrative.
But if you're close to Petra, it won't be that much difference.
Yeah. So he begins the second civil war, the Zubair. He destroys the Kaaba, and notice where the Kaaba is that he destroys. It's in Petra. He's the governor of Petra. He's living in Petra. He destroys the Kaaba there in Petra, which is probably that thing, where that mound that we have now
seen
in space.
That's what we're hoping for.
We're hoping that's it.
And he stole that black stone.
And he takes the black stone. He refers to the black stone from there and flees to the south. Doesn't say where. I'm guessing it was to the Hejaz. The Hejaz is that central area which Mecca and Medina are a part of.
That's right.
That's that central area of Arabia. But he needs an ally. So what do you do? Where do you look to for an ally? Well, you can't go to the Umayyads because you're against the Umayyads. So who do you go? Who are the ones that are in conflict with the Umayyads? Now, the Umayyads are up here in Damascus, okay? I think I've got it right geographically. They're up here in Damascus. The Abbasids are over here in Baghdad. They were the vestiges of the Sassanid Persians.
Correct.
They had been defeated by the Arabs. They were absolutely upset. They hated the Arabs who were up here in Damascus. They hated the Umayyads. So you had these two great empires, Damascus, Baghdad. Zubair's down here in Petra. He flees down to the south. He needs an ally. So he looks over toward the Abbasids.
Connects with Abbasid.
He has the black stone. And remember, where the black stone is the presence of God. The presence of God follows that black stone.
That's right.
This is now looking in the Nabataean culture. The black stone is referred to all the way back in the second century. We know about the black stone, possibly a meteorite. So the black stone is significant. Where is the black stone today?
Kaaba.
It's in the Kaaba, in the corner.
So one can assume that that's where he went.
Looks like that must have been where he went, down to Mecca. Now, the Abbasids over here, and they are allying themselves with this man down here. And you can see this now. There is a contest going on.
And let me just clarify. I mean, I know some people look at this and say, you guys are really exaggerating. We're not exaggerating anything. We're taking data, and we're making now plausible assumptions based on that.
Okay, so the Abbasids, who are in control of Kufa in what is today Iraq, join this rebellion and support Zubair. Now, let's take a look. Let's look at the map and you'll see what we're talking about. Can you see where Baghdad is? Can you see where Damascus is? Those are the two black circles. Can you see where Petra is in the gold circle?
No,
and then can you see where Mecca is in the purple circle?
That's right.
Okay, there is the map there. Damascus is the political capital of the Umayyads. It is 1,000 miles north of Mecca. Petra is the religious sanctuary for the Umayyads. It is 600 miles north of Mecca. Baghdad is the political capital of the Abbasids. Mecca is the religious sanctuary of the Abbasids. Okay? Can you then see why the Abbasids have chosen Mecca, while the Umayyads have already, they've always, because they're just a continuation of the Nabataeans.
And they
the Nabataeans have always had Petra.
That's right.
Now helps you understand why, as far away as Guangzhou in 627, while Muhammad was still living way over in China, they're facing Petra.
That's
because
right.
This is a continuation of the Nabataean sanctuary.
Correct.
So that's why in Cherman, in India, which is 629, again, Muhammad would still be, if Muhammad was there, insignificant. We're going to show that Muhammad's not significant. Nonetheless, can you see then why they would be facing Petra? They're just continuing what the Nabataeans have always done. And remember, the Nabataeans were traders. And when they traded, they also instituted and introduced their temples in the far-off places, including places as far away as Canton and, of course, Cherman in India.
That's correct.
Okay, now let's move on. Because if that is the case, let's jump back now to these Umayyads. Remember the Umayyads, we do know about them. In 661, they take over. They introduce their caliphate. We don't know anything about Uthman, or about Abu Bakr, or about Ali, or about Muhammad. We don't know of any of the first four rightly guided caliphs, Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, or Ali, in any other sources outside of the Islamic traditions.
That's correct.
So are they even historical? We don't know. We do know about the Umayyads because they wrote about themselves. And what you have is the Umayyads in Damascus, they were looking, and they were part of the Abrahamic faith through Ishmael, through Hagar and Ishmael. That's why they call themselves Hagarines and Ishmaelites.
Right.
But they don't have a prophetic line. The Jews do. The Christians do.
They don't have a book.
Who are their greatest enemies? Well, their greatest enemies, of course, their biggest competition, are not really the Abbasids. They're a kind of a petty thing. Their biggest problems are the Byzantines. That's the other big empire. So you have the Byzantines against the Umayyads.
And the Byzantines represented Christianity.
There you go.
And their book is the Bible, their man is Jesus.
And they have a prophetic line through Isaac.
That's correct.
Jacob. All the Arabs are dependent on that prophetic line, but there is no Arabs in that prophetic line. Now you have now, roughly by the time Abdul Malik comes to power, they've now been in power for 40 years. They now control all the way over here from Spain to India. All that swath of land, they are the big men on the pole. They are the great empire now. But they still are dependent on the Jews and Christians for their prophetic line. They don't have an Arab identity. How do you create an Arab identity to match Jews and Christians, and especially the Byzantine Empire, which are your big competitors? Abdul Malik comes to power. He rules, if you look on the slide there, politically from 685 to 705 in Damascus. He needs an Arab identity. The Arabs had now controlled that part of the world since 642. So they have been in power for 40 years. Yet from roughly 40-year period, they were dependent on Jews and Christians to run their empire. These were called the Mawalas or the Mawalis. They were urban people. The Arabs were nomadic people. Right. They did not know how to run cities. They had to use these Jews and Christians because they were brothers through Abraham. They used them to run their cities because they were much more educated. They were literate and all the rest. They were non-Arab converts who lived in cities. The Jews and the Christians had their own prophetic line, their own identity. The Arabs needed that. They had no prophetic line, no identity of their own. This identity was created introduced by Abdul Malik. It's Abdul Malik who does that. And let's see how he does that. Look and see what he does. What do we know about Abdul Malik from history?
And I want my viewers to watch now with really pay close attention to what Dr. Jay is going to share with you.
Let's look at the slide. What does Abdul Malik do? He's now been in power for about 5 years. His father was the one that confronted the Sufyani family, threw the Sufyani family out, and introduced the Marwanid families. They are introduced in 680. All right? He rules for 5 years, and then he dies, and his son takes over, Abdul Malik. Abdul Malik wants to create that Arab identity. What does he do? The first thing he does is he introduces the coins. Now, take a look at those coins. These are the first coins at the very top are Byzantine dinar. You can see there is a picture of the emperor and his two retainers on either side. On the back side of the coin is the Byzantine cross. The Umayyads introduced their own dinars, but they are, instead of the emperor, they introduced the caliph with two retainers, and they have the Byzantine cross, except the cross piece is taken off.
That's right. You can tell that they chopped it off.
Abdul Malik comes to power, and he introduces his own image. That's his image. I didn't know Muslims could have images.
At least modern-day Muslims will say that.
See, Muslims need to go back and ask, why is it all the Umayyad caliphs, including Abdul Malik, had images? This problem with image iconographic was introduced by Abdul Malik himself. He throws off his image and introduces those coins on the bottom right side. He introduces them in 692, and look what he does. He takes off his image and introduces the script. But what is he introducing? What is that that's written on
that
coin?
That's the Shahada.
There's the Shahada. The first time we see the Shahada is on that coin. There is only one God but God, and Muhammad is his prophet. You're now introducing a new God, and you're introducing a new man.
Here is the one God and the one man.
One God and one man. That is introduced on the coins. Now, on the same time, he then builds that huge structure in Jerusalem. But he's way up in Damascus. He's not living in Jerusalem. Why does he build that structure in Jerusalem? Look at the picture on the right, and you can see the Dome of the Rock is sitting above the Church of the Sepulchre. It looks down onto the Church of the Sepulchre, which is the seat of the sanctuary for the Byzantine Christians. He puts his structure above it, bigger than it, the most resplendent structure of its day, looking down onto it. Basically saying, we are the new men in town.
And that explains what you were saying. They had control over large swath, and now he's saying to the Jews and to the Christians, where Jerusalem is dear to them, we are superior.
We are, and this is what you do. You show it by having the greatest structure. They're built by Byzantine architects.
That's what the Ottomans did, right?
Thumb in their nose. Thumb in their nose at them. And it's built using their same architectural structure, the same design. But it's the biggest one of its day. Now, let's go look at that significance of the Dome of the Rock. It employs the same Byzantine architecture, much larger and more prominent. It sits above the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. It is situated in the holiest city for Jews and Christians. Why not in Damascus or Mecca? Because that's not where the Jews and Christians are. They're in Jerusalem.
That's correct.
The Muslims say this because of the Miraj. That's why the Miraj had to be introduced to give significance to Jerusalem. So now let's look at the only part of the Dome of the Rock that exists today.
And also, if I may make this reference, the Qur'an made reference to this as if it's a historical thing, not a prophetic thing about the mosque.
Okay.
Did not talk about it as if it will be built or he ascended from the place of the future mosque. No, it talks about it as if it was there when he ascended.
And so when you ask any Muslim today, and I'm talking to Muslims right now, when you ask why was the Dome of the Rock built, what do they say?
Oh, they will say because that's where the Prophet ascended and to preserve that holiness of that place and so on and so forth.
It's to commemorate the Miraj.
That's right.
That seven going up to the seven levels of heaven.
That's right.
Okay, if that's so, then something should be written about it. Something on the mosque should designate
exactly.
that, right? So let's go back and let's look at the slide. Here is what the Dome of the Rock looks like inside. All of the outer part have been rebuilt and destroyed and rebuilt 11 times. 1876, finally, you get that outer structure that we have today. But the only original part are those two inner ambulatories that you see there pictured at the very center of the building. Now, when you look at those ambulatories, you need to look at the inscriptions, which are part of the original structure. Those inscriptions are in Arabic on the outer ambulatory, on the upper dome, and on the inner ambulatory. Those green arrows are pointing to where those inscriptions are today. You can read them. They're in Arabic, and look and see what they say. They say nothing about the Miraj. What do they say? Well, you have Surah 4, Ayah 171. Go ahead and read what they say.
They're just refuting Christianity, basically saying, all people of the scripture in chapter 4, 171, denying, of course, the Trinity, as you can see, say not three.
So it's confronting the Trinity, it's confronting Jesus, and it's confronting his sonship.
That's right.
Then you have Surah 17, Ayah 111. Who praise be to God who hath not taken unto himself a son. There is confronting Jesus
the
as a son of God.
God and the sonship
and
of
fatherhood
Jesus.
As well. Who hath no partner. That's Surah 5, reflecting also Surah 5, Ayah 72.
Misunderstanding the Trinity, of course.
Absolutely. Yeah. And nor hath he any protecting friend through dependence. He's not dependent on anybody else like Jesus. That's confronting Jesus, his Christology, his divinity, and the Trinity. That's confronting the whole center, the central theology of the Byzantines, Christianity. Then you have Surah 112. Now, this is fascinating. There is no God but God. There's the Shahada. He is one, that's the first part of the Shahada. He has no associate, that's against Jesus. He is God, the one God, the eternal besought of all. He begetteth not, nor was begotten. Who's that confronting?
Jesus.
Begotten Son.
That's right.
And then it says, and there is none comparable unto him. Muhammad is the messenger of God. So it confronts the God of Christianity, and it introduces the prophet's name. That's the first time we see the prophet's name. It's introduced on the coins. It's introduced on the Dome of the Rock. And then on top of that, it's also introduced on the protocols, the caliphal protocols. These are the official documents. Now, Dr. Juhud Neva looked at the protocols, and he noticed that all the way from the Sufyani period, there is no reference to Muhammad, no reference to Muslims, no reference to Islam on any of the protocols. There's no Shahada there. There's no reference to any Quran until 691. That's the date. The date's the Quran. The Dome of the Rock is being built. That's also the year before the coins are introduced with
That's
the Shahada on it.
That's correct.
In 691, almost overnight, the Shahada is introduced on all the protocols. And from that time on, in 691, every protocol starts with the Shahada. So, beginning with the Dome of the Rock, it's the largest structure than any other Arab structure. It's facing the Arab sanctuary, Petra. It incorporates inscriptions against Byzantine Christianity. It introduces the faith Islam. It introduces the people Muslim. It introduces the Prophet Muhammad. The caliphal protocols change overnight in 691. Then he mints new coins in 692. So he replaces the images with Arabic script and introduces the Shahada on the coins. So now you have it on the structure of the mosque. You have it on the coins and you have it in the protocols.
Right.
The Shahada is introduced. Once Abdul Malik introduces Muhammad, he then needs to have an Arab revelation. Here is the problem. So that comes after he has introduced the Prophet. Every Prophet has to have a book. The earliest Quranic texts are on the Dome of the Rock in 691. The earliest Quranic manuscripts begin to appear during his reign. The lower texts of the Sana that we talked about in the former episodes, that's in the late 7th century. The Quranic manuscripts begin to proliferate during the reign of his son Al-Walid from 705 to 715. None of the manuscripts are complete, nor they are parallel to the Quran completely. They continue to be changed and corrected by later caliphs up until the 9th century. The Quran is finally canonized at Al-Azhar University in Cairo in 1924. Just in this case, it should be 94 years ago. And finally, as we shall see, there is still currently 31 different versions of the Arabic Quran that even exist today. They need a place. So what do? Two empires are competing again. Here we're now putting the whole scenario together. The Umayyad and later the Nabatean, an earlier Nabatean sanctuary in Petra is destroyed by an earthquake in 713. Remember I told you 713 is important. Once you have an earthquake that destroys a sanctuary, God's presence leaves from that place. Now can you see why that even the Umayyads needed to find a new place? They could not use Petra anymore.
That's correct.
Thus, a new place is needed. Mecca is first noted in 727. That's the first mosque that we know of. There may have been earlier ones that are closer, but that's the first one that exists still today. Possibly chosen by the rebel Abdul al-Mazin Zubair and those from Kufa, the Abbasids, in defiance of the Umayyads in Petra, the Abbasids and Zubair, with the sanctuary in Mecca, then demand allegiance to the surrounding tribes. All those Qiblas facing Mecca are those who are ally themselves with the Abbasids. Al-Hajjaj then comes in the about 705. He rebels also against them, and it is his mosques which are facing in between the other two sanctuaries.
That's right.
Waiting to see who's going to win out in this battle. So he's been very clever not to give allegiance to either the Abbasids or the Umayyads. He's already rebelled against the Umayyads. Those in North Africa and in Andalusia don't show allegiance to either empire, so have mosques facing parallel to each sanctuary. And when the Abbasids finally overpower the Umayyads in 749, most of the Qiblas then face Mecca, with a few holdouts until 822, after which they all face Mecca up to the present time. Now, here we're going to end now. Here is the what-if possibility. The Muslims have a prophet introduced in 691. They need a revelation. That's where the Quran starts to be introduced, in 705 and later. A sanctuary then is needed. That doesn't come till 741. Then they need a history. Can you then understand? You've got all these other places.
Right.
You've got to place this man in history. Can you now understand why the Sira is not introduced till 833?
Because now you need a history.
The Hadith are not introduced until 870.
Because you need teachings.
There you go. The Tafsir is not introduced until 923.
You need explanation of this new book.
By the 9th century, they now have a book, the man, the place, and the story. A new religion is formed and growing, not from within 22-year period, but evolving over 200 to 300 years. Now, that makes sense. What about Muhammad? Well, since much of what we know about him in early Islam is in doubt, since much of the Quran is also in doubt, since nothing is known of Muhammad until the 7th century, or Mecca until the mid-8th century, or his story until the 9th century, hundreds of years later, and hundreds of miles away, can we then conclude, and here we're going to get now, can we then conclude that Islam is nothing more than a later redaction possibly begun by Abdul Malik, started with him, then continued by his descendants, proving Muhammad had nothing to do with the Quran? So who is he and what is his purpose? It looks like the Muslims have the wrong man at the wrong place, doing the wrong thing at the wrong time. One more slide. What about Jesus? Let's end with Jesus.
Amen to that.
How should we critique him? Using the same historical criteria I've just used for Muhammad and Islam, we know where Jesus was born. He was born in Bethlehem. We know where Jesus grew up. He grew up in Nazareth. We know where Jesus died and when in Jerusalem, even the year he died, 33 AD. We know what Jesus did for the last 3 years of his ministry. We know this all from eyewitness accounts, Matthew and John. We know this as well from hostile accounts, Thallus, Tacitus, Josephus. Thallus was Greek. Tacitus was Roman. Josephus was Jewish. None of them were Christians. These are critical accounts, yet they all support what the Bible says on his death there. We know when they were written, between 50 to 60 years, by the eyewitness and those who knew the eyewitnesses. We know that few doubt his historicity. Nobody doubts who Jesus was or where he lived or that where he died. Thus, Christians have the right man at the right place doing the right thing at the right time.
Amen.
Can you see what we've done here?
Amen.
In
Amen.
One fell swoop, Amen. We have shown using we've just used historical evidence. We've used names, dates, places, events. We've looked at manuscript. We did that earlier in the early one. We've looked at artifacts. And we've looked at what is still existing today, the Qiblas, the mosques. In every case, we have seen that the mosques are facing the wrong direction. We don't have any reference to people called Muslims or Islam or a book called the Quran or even Muhammad really as a prophet until the Dome of the Rock and the coins and, of course, the protocols. That's 60 years too late. And we have no reference to Mecca until 741, not even put on maps until the 900s. I thank God I don't have to defend Muhammad
amen,
or the Quran.
Amen and amen. Thank you so much, brother. You can see why having Dr. J. Smith with us here has been a huge blessing to all of us and allowing us also to unpack this rich information that probably some of you have seen it in longer seminars, and we intended really to take it and piecemeal it so that it's easier for everyone to track the arguments and come back to it again. Dr. J, thank you so much. Hopefully you can continue to join me at least in the next few days to keep talking about other issues related to Islam and its history and its theology.
God bless you. Thank you so much.
You're welcome. Here is my appeal to you as my Muslim friends. you need to know now the right God who sent the right word to reveal the right man who knows the right way back to God. God bless you, and hope to see you in eternity. Thanks for watching. Make sure to like and subscribe so that you don't miss future videos. And please consider becoming a patron on patreon.com/CIRA International.